So people can live decades with CLL, and they can live decades without needing treatment. Everyone's a little bit different, and some of that has to do with the age that you're diagnosed. Some of it has to do with the disease, your disease biology as well. Some of that can be told by some of the genetic tests that we send on your CLL. I call it, it gives me a little bit of a flavor of how I think your CLL is going to behave potentially over time. And I think that some of that we can tell also by within the first couple of years by what your blood counts do over time. Now, the natural history of CLL is eventually your white blood cell count is going to go up. And the first time that happens, it feels very scary for sure, because you don't really know how that's going to happen over time. But just because your white blood cell count goes up on one blood count doesn't mean it might not come back down. CLL cells are pretty what I call reactive. And so if there's anything going on, if you have an infection, if you had a surgery, your white blood cell count can go up. And it doesn't mean it'll necessarily stay that high. It can go back down. And that's something I think that we see pretty commonly in clinical practice.
And there was actually an interesting study that was presented at IWCLL that looked at all patients who were treated on modern day clinical trials. So these are patients who required treatment. And they did a study where they took all those patients and they matched them to age match controls in the general population. And the overall survival of the two groups was practically equal. So with treatment, patients were getting very, very close to the life expectancy. So with treatment, the life expectancy was, and remember, this is all clinical trials, right? So I don't want to, it's going to seem a little bit low, but I just don't want you, I don't want you to worry. So this was, it was 52 to 55 months versus age match controls, which was 56 months. So once again, it was age match controls, right? So they matched the population to age match controls to general society, and the difference was only by a few months. And so that just tells us that our patients with CLL are living very close to the normal life expectancy, even if they require treatment with our new therapies, which is a great news.
SEER, which is our sort of the National Cancer Institute data, the five-year survival rate currently for CLL is around 89%. So that means at 5 years, 89% of people that were diagnosed with CLL are still alive. What we don't always know is what that 11% death rate is from. Because CLL, the median age of diagnosis of CLL is 70. And as I'm sure we all know, as we get older, other things can happen. Things like heart disease, hypertension, motor vehicle accidents. So it doesn't necessarily take into account, you know, exactly why patients who have CLL are potentially passing away. And I think that that's also a really hard statistic to hear. And so one of the ways that I try and frame this for patients is that while we have statistics, that's taking a whole group of people and kind of figuring out sort of the trend. But people are, the only person that matters is the person in front of me, is you. And so you're kind of what we call an N of one. And so that's really, I think, an important thing to remember is that just because there's a number out there, it doesn't necessarily mean that number relates to what your story is going to be and what your journey is going to be. To my knowledge, there isn't a specific comorbid condition that puts you at risk for your CLL to progress further. We know that all lymphoid malignancies, CLL, other types of lymphoma, there's an association with other type of autoimmune diseases, and so we can see those go hand in hand. And that really probably has to do with immune dysfunction has to do with immune dysfunction potentially leading to lymphomas, or sometimes even the treatments that we give patients with autoimmune diseases can't come with a risk of lymphomas as well. If you have an autoimmune disease, it's something that your doctor will talk to you about with different types of treatment as well, to make sure that you're informed about that risk. So I think one of the challenges is that lifestyle modifications is very open-ended. And people often ask, is there a specific diet I should have? How much should I be exercising? Are there supplements or other things that I should be doing to improve my health? I think getting adequate sleep, I think making sure you're up to date on vaccinations because infection risk is slightly higher in patients with CLL, doing your routine cancer screening, and maintaining a well-balanced diet and doing some form of movement each day around 30 minutes is important just for general overall well-being. And I think that that will correlate long-term to better outcomes with CLL potentially. We've never actually studied this significantly. There's some data from UNC looking at the role of exercise in outcomes with CLL. And it does show that doing some type of weightlifting, whether that a light weightlifting routine can lead to improvements in outcomes. Though I do think that some of that is just improving your overall physical well-being leads to better outcomes and better health in general.